All right. Hello, and thank you for having me. I appreciate the invitation. My name is Andrew, and I'm the corporate vice president in charge of servers at AMD. And I thought I'd talk a little bit about the cloud in general, what we see happening in Brazil. And as this is a forum filled with policymakers and decision makers, make some suggestions as well. I think the cloud is often misunderstood. And I think if I were to ask you today in this room, what is the cloud? There'd be many, many different answers. But I think it's very simple. The cloud is a collection of concrete buildings. They're very boring. They're filled with servers. They're tied together with fiber optic cable. And what they enable is your entire population to get access to a tremendous amount of computational power. And that's the power of the cloud. To understand the cloud, we must begin on the client side. We must begin with how you in this room and the population around the world gets access to the cloud. And that begins with a very simple table. And it begins with us understanding the client side of the market. On that y-axis, we have the value of the operating system. And on the x-axis, we have the value of the CPU. And for the last 20 years, this has been about the economics of a desktop machine. The CPU cost about $150. Microsoft took about $150. And that was the dynamics of the market. What I like about this graph is we can see Microsoft's strategy and we can see the CPU maker strategy. Right? Microsoft is trying to drive down the value of the CPU, and the CPU vendors are trying to drive down the value of the software. All right? And what happens, as often happens in well-functioning markets, is we were both wrong. What we got was a much cheaper notebook, okay? And what we got was a device, all right, that the CPU cost $60 and the operating system got about $60 too. And everybody here knows what's next, right? What's next is that we got a phone. And this is the new client device, and in this client device, the CPU is $9. How many people have Samsung phones here? Samsung phones, BlackBerry phones, right, Samsung, right, right. Operating system is zero. And what is interesting about this is if you look at the desktop, all right, the desktop gained access to the internet through broadband. The netbook and ultra thins gained access to the internet through Wi-Fi and then broadband. And the Android devices and the iPhones gain access to the internet and to the cloud over cellular data. Okay? And what's so interesting about the cloud and what is so transformative about the cloud is that it takes your phone and allows a $9 processor to get access to all the world's information. Okay? It gives you access to Google. And it does that by doing no work on your phone, right? What the phone does and what the netbook does, and more now what your client computer does, is it presents information that was done, the work was done somewhere else. It was done in the cloud, okay? And in fact, the cool applications, I'm not sure I know how to translate cool into Portuguese, but I'm sure there's a good word, cool. The cool applications of the 21st century all live in the cloud. Okay, and I ask you to think about, just in this room, when's the last time you went to a store, bought a piece of software that was wrapped in a box, took it home, and installed it on your PC? That's right. That's an interesting question, isn't it? 10 years ago, that's what you did. And I can't remember the last time in 4 or 5 years that I did that. And I'm sure it's the same for you. Okay? And if you look at the places that you or your friends, all right, or your spouse or your children, where they want to go, they want to go to the cloud. They want to go to Google. They want to go to Facebook, right? They want to go play games at Level Up, or they want to go to Mercado Libre, or they want to go to Despegar, all right? This is where they want to go. And the device you have in your hand is the access point to the cloud. All the cool things today live in the cloud. In the 20th century, we bought software for our desktop. We did word processing. We did spreadsheets. We did CAD/CAM. All right, we played games on our computer. Right, that is not what we do today with computers. What we do with computers today is we search for information. We communicate with other people. We play games against other people. All right. We watch videos that were delivered to us and that are not stored on our computers. All of that is driven by the cloud. All right. And so the cloud is now fundamental and will continue to be fundamental to our lives. What are the drivers of the cloud? There are many, many words you can put together here, but the concepts are very easy. There are 4 drivers of the cloud. All right, the number of users. Okay, how often the users use. The number of devices that connect to the cloud and the applications on those devices. Okay? This is like bringing sand to the beach. You know the data better than I for sure, but I want to point out several things. Today, Brazil has internet penetration of about 42% plus or minus. It has nearly 100% cell phone penetration. Okay, so my first question is, what happens when everyone who has a cell phone moves to a smartphone? Okay, that's one thought, is you have nearly 200 million cell phone users, but a very small portion of them are using smartphones. So you have 190 million people waiting to get to a smartphone, to jump on the internet and go to the cloud. Okay? What about other devices? So here's an interesting chart showing worldwide. Worldwide, there are only about 1 billion smartphones, but nearly 6 billion cellular phones. So we have 5 billion people in the world who want a better phone, and they want the phone not because they can't make good telephone calls, they want the phone for everything that's not a telephone call. Right? Isn't that ironic? They want the phone because a smartphone is no better than a dumb phone at making phone calls. Right? So we have 5 billion people in the world who want phones to deliver what? They want smartphones to get to the cloud, to get to the information that's kept in the cloud. Something to think about. Here's a case study. This is India. And India's population began in 2008 with almost 100% of the population gaining internet access, all right, from the desktop. But over a 4-year period, the number of people who got onto the internet from their phone passed the number of people who regularly got on with their desktop. One of the interesting things about your phone is it's always with you. So you get on to the internet and into the cloud more often. I know you don't do this, but sometimes in USA we do this while we're driving. All right, while we're waiting for the bus, while our wife is talking to us and we're not listening, while we're talking to our wife and she's not listening, right? You are on your phone in the cloud a great deal of the time, and it's not just the number of devices, it's how often. These are all driving cloud demand. This is my favorite slide because it's a personal slide. This is my grandmother on the left. Now you look up. That's nice. Thank you. Not so many people present photos of their family. This is my grandmother, and this is my car, and this is my dog. Okay? That is my grandmother. She's 97. Right? This is not the demographic we think of as being early adopters of cloud technology, right? 97. She's on Skype and she's talking to her great-grandchild 9,000 miles away. Okay? This is my car. I have an electric car. This is a Tesla. Okay? This is an app where the Tesla tells me at any time where it is, how much charge is left in the battery, right? What my cruising distance is. I can turn the car on in case it's cold so I can get in and it's warm. I can run a diagnostic from my desk at my office on my car. Okay? And that's my dog, Lola. Okay? Lola likes rabbits. And what we found is we couldn't build a fence that kept her in our house, on our property. She would chase rabbits not just to the neighbor, but out of the neighborhood and into the next neighborhood. So I got her a GPS tracking collar. And now I can follow her with my cell phone, and I know where she is. Okay? So here are three little things in which my life is always connected into the cloud. Now, those are personal items. Those aren't big government items. But this is. All right? The image on the left was a small town in India where all the farmers lined up to get government subsidies. And this happened across India. And India decided instead, all right, to subsidize a phone and deliver the subsidy via cell phone. 200 million farm subsidies delivered over the phone. Okay? Transformation of policy of how we deliver agricultural subsidies in India. Okay? What's interesting is that over the last 3 years, the top 10 countries in the world added about 444 million internet users. Worldwide, we added about 663 million internet users. What's interesting is the far right side is that internet penetration is only a third. We have 4 or 5 billion people who are going to step up into the internet. And they're going to get their data from Google. All right? And if Google builds their data center not in Brazil, it's bad for Brazil. And if Facebook builds their facility not in Brazil, it's bad for Brazil. And if Apple builds their facilities in somewhere else, you understand the combination. To give you an idea how quickly the world is changing, this is the rate of growth of devices. And over 12 quarters, all right, Android phones and iPhones shipped more than 300 million units. Okay, that's a lot of units. Those are a lot of people who are getting new access to the cloud. Here's my one table on USA. Because even in the USA, where we're inventing some things, we are surprised. Over a 12-quarter period, the number of iPad users or e-book reader users went up from 2% to 29%. All right? So now I have a phone, I have an iPad, I have an e-reader, I have a laptop, and I go to work and I have a desktop. My car speaks to the cloud, my grandmother speaks to the cloud, my dog. All right, this is coming. New users, new devices, new applications, this driving the demand for the cloud. I saw this happening in 2006, and in 2007 I started a company that AMD has acquired that built a set of servers designed to solve the problems of the cloud. The problems in the cloud are very simple: power, space, bandwidth, storage. And we developed a set of servers that use, all right, a fraction of the power, that use less space, that deliver more bandwidth and provide more storage. Okay? We were bought by AMD in 2012, and they seem to like me because now I'm in charge of all servers, not just server systems, but also server chips. When you think about the problems in the cloud, power and space are number one and number two. It often costs more for the electricity over the life of a server than it did to buy the server in the beginning. The operating expense is greater than the capital expense. And then if your network has a bottleneck, you can't get access to your compute, so you need to have plenty of bandwidth. And all this data that is being generated and being captured has to be stored. These are the primary problems. What was interesting when we began thinking about how to build a better server was to examine what has happened. And what has happened is work changed. The nature of compute changed. I see some of you in the audience have gray hair. All right, when we did work in the past in compute, it was usually at a company. There were a few number of users. It was big problems. All right, it was math intensive. It wasn't photos of the grandkids. All right, and what's more, if you look at the last item, it was easy to schedule because we told our employees, wait, you'll get your compute tomorrow. What if Google told you to wait? We'll give you the answer to your search in an hour. All right? And that doesn't happen. What happened was the nature of work changed fundamentally. We went from a small number of users, mostly employees, to many, many users, hundreds of millions of users worldwide. The work they were doing changed. The traffic pattern changed. We began sending rich content, photo, video. This isn't what we did at work. What we did at work was database, primarily. Okay? And we had to build infrastructure so our customers never waited. All this happened, but the server vendors made no changes. They delivered the same servers year after year without improvement. So we had more devices, we had different workloads, we had different traffic patterns, we had more data, and the servers were the same. That's not good. We saw that as an opportunity to disrupt this market and to transform the cloud server market. The first thing we did is we evaluated where power lives in a server, and we found something very interesting, that in a server, the CPU only consumes a small portion of the power. And so what my team did and continues to do here at AMD is we spent 5 years and $100 million shrinking the power used by the orange section here, everything else. We shrunk it to a tiny fraction. And the result was we redesigned the server from the ground up, and we were able to slash the usage of power, increase compute and storage density. We were able to allow you, the user, better utilization and we were able to simplify the management of these machines. The result is one of our machines replaces 60 traditional servers. It replaces their disk, it replaces their switches, it replaces the management infrastructure, and it replaces all that in something this tall. Something in 10 rack units, half the power, a third the space, 10 times the bandwidth, and a quarter the weight. I know everybody here is an electrical engineer, right? I guess not. So I will move through this fast. We invented three technologies. The first technology allowed us to eliminate components from the motherboard, shrink the motherboard. The second technology allowed us to reach into the processor and turn off things that you don't need. And the third technology we invented allowed us to tie together hundreds of these motherboards at very low cost. This is what a traditional server looks like. Can you hear me, Mike? All right, there are hundreds and hundreds of components. It looks very similar to a PC from 1985. Okay. This is what our motherboard looks like. It has three components. It has a processor, it has memory, and it has our chip. That's it. Three components. We took a system down from 400 or 500 components to three. We then fit 64 of these into a single system. And we transformed the amount of compute you can get in a data center. We transformed the amount of bandwidth you could bring to a computer, to a server. We provided more bandwidth inside and outside. We allow you to connect 5 petabytes of storage to one machine. So we transformed every aspect of the data center's server. That's on the server side. At AMD, we have more than 2 million processors powering the cloud worldwide. We've invented new servers, like this one. But that's not enough. Okay? New ideas like the cloud require vendors to think differently. They require policymakers to think differently. They require CIOs and executives to think differently. So we're also thinking differently. And one of the ways we're thinking differently is we've designed a set of servers and we've open sourced them. We've given away the design. So manufacturers around the world can take advantage of best practices in server design. It's not just Dell or HP or IBM. Now, any manufacturer in the world can have access to a best-in-class server design. That's one idea we had. Another idea we have, all right, is to let go of our religious view on x86 in the processor. So we are also, one of my teams is also building ARM-based processors. All your cell phones have ARM-based processors in them. And starting next year, servers will have ARM-based processors in them too. All right, so it's a time when I'm encouraging you, all right, as you think about policy and ideas and your businesses, to let go of some of the tradition. Because it's not well suited for the new environment. I'm going to conclude with 4 observations and some thoughts as you set policy. The first, I think, is perhaps most important, and that's infrastructure. Data centers need clean power, all right? and we need to be sure that facilities get clean power. We need to be sure that homes have broadband access. And we need to make demands of our telcos, of our carriers, that they give, all right, high cellular data services. And I know the telco carriers say it's difficult. Don't believe them. All right. In Shanghai, one of the world's largest cities, 21 million people, perfect cellular data coverage, always. Always. There's no reason we can't do this in São Paulo. There's no reason we can't do this here. We can't do this in every major city in Brazil. The second is competition. Okay, you need to be careful of vendors who give you advice that in the end benefits them and not you. Right now, particularly in the cloud, all right, a lot of the existing vendors lose. They don't win. Storage vendors lose right now in the cloud. Software vendors lose as we move to open source software. Okay? And if you just listen to the biggest software vendors, they will tell you what's good for them. Open standards, we must look for ways, all right, to allow what is manufactured and designed and built here to interoperate around the world and vice versa. It must be easy for us to do business here, and conversely, for your Brazilian companies to do business worldwide. And finally, innovation. There is no reason that computer innovation needs to live in two cities south of San Francisco. There's no reason for that. And there are policies and there are things that can be done at the government level and also at the corporate level to push for innovation.